Did you know 30,000 hours of video is uploaded onto YouTube every single hour? Now, how much is that? That's like almost 3.5 years worth of content on YouTube every single hour. That really, seriously, that blows my mind. Videos are powerful. Videos are much more than just cats and dances and tutorials. Videos are a medium of visual storytelling that has way more potential than we have currently reached. Making a video, however, is often more complicated than it looks. Now, yes, it can be simplified by just sitting in front of a camera and talking to it and uploading it with minimal amount of editing, but that's not my cup of tea. The real fun is in the process of scripting, shooting, editing, color grading, SEO, and much, much more. So after a whole lot of requests, I'm finally talking about the 20 steps process I follow to make my videos. The journey of a video always starts with an idea to show or a story to tell. And I'm not gonna lie, coming up with a video idea is sometimes very, very stressful. I get most of my ideas when I'm doing something completely unrelated. Initially, I used to overestimate the power of my memory and I have suffered quite a lot about that. So now I either keep my phone or some kind of diary or some kind of note like close by. So that's a new banger video idea right there. Soon to come. As soon as a new idea occurs to me, I can quickly open a note on my phone or open my diary to note it down. Later, when I open Notion, I add it to the video ideas lists formally, and it consists of the types of videos like informative, productivity, storytelling, vlogs, whether it's a collab or not, or whether or not the particular video has a deadline. Now, after you have come up with an idea, it's often the case that you don't know very much about that particular topic and you lack some facts. So that is where Googling comes in, or the fancy term, research. When I need to learn more about the topic that I want to make a video about, researching is very, very helpful. Now, I admit that the word researching is really fancy for something as simple as Googling and looking through the internet, but it is what it is. So whatever I get from the internet, I note it all back down to the Notion board, which I create for every video. And there is a particular research part where I note down all the research that I found on the internet. By the way, I use Notion to plan each and everything about my video making process. Now that I have all the pieces that I needed to talk about this chosen topic, next comes planning the video. And this is probably the one that drains my creative energy the most. This is the part where I decide if I want a hyped up intro or a formal one. I also decide if I should get straight to the point or should I linger around the audience with a little bit of hook around the start, and I come up with the whole flow of the video in this point. Whether it'll be a calm, aesthetic video or a frantic, fast-paced video, from B-roll ideas to ending credits, everything is planned in this part to as much detail as possible. Little quick note for people who don't know what a B-roll is, the main content of the video where I'm talking is called the A-roll, and the clips, which are not primary but enriches the experience, are called B-roll. Okay, moving on. Now, this is probably the most time-consuming part of this process, unless it's a vlog, obviously. But yes, I focus a lot on storytelling these days, and like a lot of other people will tell you, story is king. Even if you're not shooting with a camera and shooting into your phone, even if you don't have amazing editing skills, a good compelling story is always appreciated by your audience. And as much as I talk about it, I'm not personally very good at storytelling, and that is something I'm doubling down more and more these days. And that is why these days I'm thinking more about how I narrate the story, how I structure the story, and how I connect different parts of the story as well. If you have been watching my recent videos, you might have seen that I'm getting a little bit better and I'm improving about how to pace the video and how the whole story goes around. I'm also letting the viewer relax after the fast-paced B-roll. I'm creating tension at crucial places. I mean, there are so many tiny things that can improve how an audience goes through a story and how the storytelling feels. And I'm saying this again, I'm nowhere near as good as I want to be in storytelling. If there is one skill I want to improve and want to master in my life, it would be storytelling, hands down. After the story is written in words, it sure can make a good blog post, but we don't do that here. We make videos and we just don't tell stories, we show them. The visual storytelling is a skill with completely different components. From pacing the video, planning where to cut, to adjusting composition, everything is done in this place. Like in my own storytelling videos, you will often see at least one shot about the environment the character is in. is in, the character is in, and that gives the mood to the audience, that makes the audience feel the environment. Like when the subject is feeling stuck in life, placing him or her in a way so that they have less space in front of them inside the frame, this really suffocates the viewer compared to the shot where there is a lot of room in front of the subject. Now, these are one of the things that the viewers don't notice. They will rarely notice any of these compositional changes, but it really tells this story subconsciously to the viewer. And that is one of my favorite things. These things, basically, I should say, are one of my favorite things in video making. I call them catalysts. Catalysts are basically things that don't really show up much, but they do their job. They enrich the whole experience, but the viewers won't even notice it. Obviously, more shots can make a video less monotonous. I've counted the number of shots on the short list of this video, and it's exactly 142. That is probably the most amount of shots I've ever taken in for any kind of video ever. Now, talking about catalysts, other catalysts are like camera movement and transitions that all really play a huge role in telling a story. A lot of camera movement or a lot of quick cuts give a frantic vibe when a character is moving through a jumble of thoughts or going through a fluid motion of things, whereas a steady or longer footage will give a more calmer vibe. I've been saying vibe. It's vibe. Yeah, it's vibe. Vibe. Now in comes the first part of the process that is not taking place inside of Notion, and finally we are moving out of our room, that is shooting. I used my Fujifilm X-T200 for this, along with a tripod, a GorillaPod, and occasionally my Redmi Note 5. In most videos, I keep at least one interesting shot or multiple shots that take a long time to set up or a long time to shoot. Basically, a lot of time consuming shots. For example, if I need a film with a simple sequence of me picking up the phone and unlocking it, I need to set the tripod and adjust the focus for 3 times and also do everything multiple times because you don't know which one will fit perfectly into the video. So it's always safe to have some kind of backup because you don't want to be getting into editing and then realizing that this does not look good, go out again to shoot and then again come back. That's a lot of hassle and I don't have that much time for doing this. And that is the best part about planning. If I have planned everything to a minute detail beforehand, I don't have to get into that hassle and I can only work on one part of the process at one time. And also, if I have shortlisted everything, I don't have to plan or I don't have to shoot on spot and think about what shots should I take. I already have that everything listed out on my phone that is already open when I'm shooting. I keep the particular Notion board open on my phone. As soon as I'm done taking a shot, I check it off the list. And every once in a while, I'll find this amazingly fabulous shot or composition that is sadly not in the short list, but I will take it regardless. And I'll probably use it somewhere else or maybe in that video. But again, as you should remember, if it doesn't help to tell the story, get rid of it, no matter how interesting that shot is. You can just use it in a vlog later. Now the next part, that is the setup, which is not involved in every video. But if there is some video where I need to be talking to the camera for some amount of time, there are a few variables that I need to consider. First of all, it has to be early morning or late night, or it has to be around the evening when other people are sleeping in my family, because I need as less noise as possible. And also around those times, I get less vehicles passing through the road. So that really helps. The second factor is that I don't have an AC and I can't shoot with a fan on. This is how it sounds with the fan. Again, the background noise is a bit too much. So basically, if it's a really hot day when I can't keep a t-shirt on without turning on my fan, I can't really record that day. I've tried going downstairs under the trees where it's a little bit cooler, but again, that is another horrible experience. And now you certainly see the difference. It's a lot quieter with my fan turned off. The weather is really nice around here these days, so it is really easier to shoot. And when all the stars align, I need to put the tripod, attach the camera, put my lights on, which is literally a tube light with a hoodie on. For the mic I used to use back in the day, it was a Boya M1 B1 or it's a Boya B1 M1. I'm not really sure. It's one of that. You can find a link somewhere in the description. It could be plugged in directly to the camera and the audio from the mic would be recorded inside the footage itself. But for the new mic I got a few weeks ago, it's a Blue Yeti. And it's a USB mic, unlike the other one. It can't be plugged into the camera. Trust me, I have tried. So I have to record my voice separately on Audacity, which is a free audio editing and audio recording software that I use on my laptop, and later sync the audio and the video in Premiere while editing. I also kept my script open on Notion while I'm talking to the camera because my memory is really horrible, and then it's just me looking at the script and talking to the camera as long as it takes. VoiceOver is a really sophisticated process and I am trying desperately to improve it. I don't record this VoiceOver part along with the talking head part of my video because I think I can do better and in terms of setup. And when I'm doing VoiceOver, I don't have to worry about what my background looks like. And so I take that to my advantage and build my own setup. And I don't have acoustic panels on my room or soundproofed walls or anything like that. So it's basic jugaad, as we like to say. I get a couple of cushions to build a wall behind the mic and I cover the top with a blanket sometimes. This basically reduces the echo coming from the walls as like soft surfaces like this absorb sound pretty well. It's again a chunk of time of me talking into the mic while reading the script. If you have been watching my channel for long enough, you know that I talk in a very monotonous voice. So that is why I am trying to bring more energy into my narration and my talking and bring more dynamics into how I talk. But yeah, not everything goes with everyone's personality. I can't just be like, hey guys, today we're gonna prank my dad, telling that I'm dropping out of college, being a full-time YouTuber. It's gonna be epic. You know that. I know that. Let's go. Watch the video till the end and it will be a blast. Damn, that was really tiring for a 10 second line, and as you can see, it doesn't work for everyone. Now coming to the organizing part, all the mic and the camera work is done and I have got all the footages and all the sound effects, everything is gathered into one place and everything else takes place in my laptop. I have to import all the footages from my camera to my laptop and I have to name them accordingly. I don't name footages if there are not many footages, but where there are a lot of footages like this video, it gets really confusing and takes a lot of time to find them while editing. Cause DSCF0609 is not a very intuitive name, let's be honest. In the organizing process, I also get the stock footages and the other footages that I need from the internet. Now as you might have feared, I cannot be ready enough for this editing process. I will eventually have to stop in parts of editing and download something from the internet, some sound effect or some song or something else. That will happen, but if I do everything else and plan everything else accordingly, that chance will be a lot lesser. Now next we come on to music, and most people don't realize that music is one of the most integral part of a video about telling a story and about giving away the mood to the audience. It is really, really important. Like the same scene with different types of background music will give different vibe to the audience. Music can make a shot seem calm, energetic, angry, dramatic, scary, and everything in between. I get my hands on some basic copyright-free music which might suit the video. And there are also times when I find some kind of copyrighted music that feels really, really good fit for the video and I will end up using it. Yes, it will get my video demonetized. I will not earn a single penny for the hours I put in. But yes, that's okay. We are doing it for the art. And after this, we get into the realm of editing, probably the most interesting part in the whole process. Now the next few steps take place inside Adobe Premiere Pro CC. I use the 2019 version. While importing, I make separate bins for footages, talking heads, music, effects, sound effects, and import all into their respective bins. Now, in case of most footages, only a small part of it is useful, and the first task is to skim through all the footages and select the in and out points of the useful parts. And after all the in and out points are done, it is basically me looking through the script once again to see how the flow and how the order of things went, and getting those clips into the timeline and ordering them in a particular manner. I manage the overlaps and the speeds of different clips and use time remapping to create speed ramps if that is needed anywhere, but nothing more than that in this part of the process. Now the next part of the process is editing 2.0. Maybe we can call it the cooler editing. This is where all the fun effects, all the whip transitions, the zoom transitions, swirl transitions and luma fades, everything, all of that fun stuff take place in this part of the editing process. There are a lot of stock transitions available in Premiere Pro, but they're mostly garbage, never use them. I only use like this normal cut, the normal G cut, the L cut, swipe transitions and crossfades, mainly those things. Those are the transitions that I personally use. And I also add text in this part and add certain overlays like dust overlays or something that makes sense at that point. Adding motion blur, basic 3D effects and everything that can alter the actual vision of this part is done here. And then I generally look through the whole video 2 or 3 times to see if anything can be done better. If I find anything off-putting or something that can be done better, I'll go ahead and fix it before I get into the next part. Now next is the crispy part of the all the whooshes and the splashes, and it is sound design. It is probably one of the biggest catalysts in a film or in a video in my opinion. It adds so much character to a shot or a sequence, it enriches the experience and make the viewer feel the shot in a more immersive way. Just like any other catalyst, people would often overlook any of these things and not notice these things consciously, but they again do a really huge job in telling the story. So how do I go forward with the sound design part of making a video? I look for all the parts where a sound design can be used. From pouring water into a glass to a thunderstorm, from walking on sand to seagulls, almost every sound effect can be found on the internet somewhere or the other. Now when someone first finds out about sound design, their mind is definitely blown and they rile up their videos with a lot of sound design and they kind of ruin its purpose. Sound design is best when it's used less and at a lower volume. That is what I wanted to say. Jumble of tongue. Shit. Anyways, so the main talking of the video, the narration, the voiceover, whatever you want to call it, the main narration, the main background music and the sound design, all of this should work in harmony. They should not interfere with each other. That is something really important, and that is a skill that I am also learning now, and that takes a little bit of time to master. And in my recent days, I also understood that background music is not really a compulsion. I can have a footage, have me talking in a video without background music at some point, if that makes sense. So that is something I'm trying to incorporate more and more, like this shot. And it's all about these small things. I think it's safe to say that I'm learning something new with every new video I make, and that is the most exciting part about all of this. I should get really hyped, but I'm really bad at showing my excitement. That's something I need to work on, definitely. Now at this point of the process, if you look at the video, it looks absolutely fine. And to be honest, it can be literally exported and uploaded without any tension. But, I cannot do that, because I have to color correct and color grade my videos. This is another skill that I'm pretty new to and I'm learning a lot currently. Mostly from channels like Jiera Lee, Aiden Robbins and other amazing filmmakers on YouTube. People often confuse color correction with color grading. Color correction is making the footage look as close to reality as possible. Bring it as close to how it looked in real life. That is what color correction is all about. This mostly includes tuning the white balance and the tint of the shot and adjusting exposure, contrast, etc. So that is part of the reason you see white in my recent videos. So I can pick the eyedropper tool and click on something that is white in real life, and Premiere will do its best to adjust the temperature and the tint and make a perfect combination so the colors become as close to life as possible. I'm not going deeper into the other parts of the basic color correction process and moving on to the next point. That is probably the most exciting thing right now for me, color grading. After the color correction is done, it is now time to give our own touch to the colors. And in any mainstream video editing software like Premiere Pro or Final Cut or anything like that, you can generally do it in two ways. Number one is to use LUTs. LUTs are lookup tables, basically some kind of preset that someone else had already made about the color, and you can just click on one button and use that preset on your videos just that quickly. So often the good LUTs are very, very expensive. So that is not what we do here. We go with the second route, that is using Lumetri color panels. I generally create an adjustment layer and switch to the color workspace. Now everything that I do on Lumetri color is solely based on what those particular clips are looking like and what type of mood I want to convey through those clips. Color grading makes a lot of difference in how much it affects the viewer. I don't mess with the curve that much. If I'm going for a moody look, however, I'll make a subtle S-curve by pulling down the shadows and bumping up the highlights just a little bit. I'd often desaturate my blues and the greens and make my greens a little bit more minty, make my blue a little bit more closer to teal color, and also add a little redness to my yellows and my browns. Now this is something I learned from Aidan Robbins. I will, in almost all my clips, desaturate the absolute whites and the absolute blacks, and it is totally fine if you don't understand any of this. It's totally fine. Now there is something called Lumetri scopes that really seems intimidating at first, but once you understand it, it's a really powerful tool to see how your color grading process is going and what is missing in a footage and what kind of color, what kind of tint it might be needing. Well, if you're talking about color grading, I can go on all day and all night about the nooks and crannies and all the little details and the little tricks I have learned from somewhere on YouTube or somewhere on the internet about color grading, but we are not gonna do that as this video is already getting quite long. We are gonna move on to the next part. So at this point, your video is ready. It is looking fine as, but inside Premiere Pro, now you have to export it inside your computer basically. Before exporting, I will rewatch the whole video 2-3 times and look for potential improvements, and after either I'm satisfied with the result or it's really late in the Saturday night and I don't have much time, I would move to the export menu. And you might have noticed that recently I've been using 4K as my choice of resolution, and as Peter McKinnon said, I guess 1 year ago, I am really late to this, but I am making my videos in 18:9 instead of 16:9 because all the new devices have a screen that is 18:9 and that just looks better even in 16:9. After I've hit the export button, it will take quite some time to render the video. While the video is rendering, I cannot do anything else on my laptop or this shit will actually blow up. So that is when I will pick up my guitar and try to play something, and I will also keep my eye on the progress bar that is moving really, really slowly. After the video is done rendering, I would watch it again to see how good of a job Premiere has done in preserving the colors. And it's finally time to upload the video. This does not take long, but the video processing on the platform takes a little time for 4K and HD videos. And while this is going on, I will move on to the next step of the process. That's called SEO. If you don't know what SEO is, great job, you're doing fine in your life. But if you want to know, it's called search engine optimization. It basically decides how often will it occur on other people's feeds, how high it will show up on a ranking when someone searches by a particular key phrase or a particular term. So that is something really important if you want to get your videos to more people. The description and the tags all come into play. Almost every YouTuber uses some kind of extension for assistance with SEO. I personally use vidIQ. Now, apart from all of this, I also have to think about the title of the video, because no matter how good your video is, nobody is gonna click on the video if it has a really boring title. And your title has to be intriguing, interesting, a little bit confusing, or it can literally be a copy of some popular search term that gives a good ranking. Again, I'm going into way more detail at this point, and let's just move on to the next step. And finally, last but not the least, the face of the video, the thumbnail, that is made. I make my thumbnails in Adobe Photoshop. There are many types and possibilities with the design of the thumbnail. 4 components or 1 component or a 3 component, and with a classy title or with a huge title on the thumbnail and so on. There are many other options to choose from, and it is somewhere to let your creative juices flow. And as much as I talk about it, I am not very good at editing thumbnails and getting the viewers' attention. I am trying my best to improve with each and every video. After setting the thumbnail, the only last step is remaining, and that is to publish the video. And it is almost never a good idea to straight away publish a video after you uploaded it, because there are some kind of checks copyrighted music and everything else running. So it is almost always a good idea to keep your video for at least 1 hour in the unlisted phase, which is also suggested by YouTube itself. So that is something I do. And so it is generally Sunday morning when I wake up. Before 12 p.m. obviously, and I will schedule the video to 12 p.m. on that day. After this, YouTube makes it really easy to dive into how the video is doing and what people are saying about it. And unlike before, I read the comments later in the day now, and I still read most of the comments on the first day and try to reply to the interesting ones. And I stopped worrying about all these small analytics that YouTube gives you, because that is another bit of headache, I would say. See, I make videos because I love to make videos, and I am really grateful to all of you guys who have been supporting me through this journey. Now, if you're watching till this point, there is something really important you should know, that there is no right or a wrong way of making a video. Whatever I talked about in this video is just my way of making a video at this point of time. Maybe 6 months or 1 year from now in the future, I would be making in a completely whole different manner. And that is the best thing about any creative process, that you keep improving and you keep evolving yourself to fit that whole process better, if that makes any sense. And that's what is beautiful about this whole process, that you can make your own way through all of this, make your own signature, make your own identity, and make your own style through all of this, and nobody is there to stop you. So as long as I'm making videos, I promise you will never see me settling in. You will never see me get comfortable. The best thing about any creative process is that there is always room to improve, and I will never stop learning. I will never stop pushing myself to make better videos, and I will never ever stop trying to tell better stories. I think I have all the shots, all the 142 shots that I needed, with a few extra, so it might have reached 150 by now. Yeah, this will be a pretty long video. If you're watching till now, really kudos to you. You are a hero, I must say. And we reached 87k, I think a few days back. Okay, not a few days back, about a week back, because this video will upload it on Sunday. So yeah, that is something I need to keep in mind. Really thanks everyone for watching. You guys know what to do. Go down there and do all the rituals. So that will be me. So that is all from me. This is me signing off. Bye bye. That didn't work.